CMS, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to this third annual meeting of the Catholic Immigrant Integration Initiative. CMS, my agency, is a Catholic think tank on international migration, which was founded 51 years ago by the missionaries of St. Charles Scalabrines. And the charism, or the mission of these priests, is service to migrants and love of migrants. So they work with migrants all over the world. Let me first acknowledge some of our own staff. And I wanted to, if you could raise your hand in back there, Rachel Reyes, Daniela Alulema in the very back there, and Reese Johnson for helping to organize this event. So thank you to them. And I'm going to do a few more thank yous, and then I'm going to speak about this particular initiative and why we're here in El Paso. And then I'm going to introduce the man to my left, Hosffman Ospino, who is going to be delivering the first annual Father Lydio Tomasi lecture on migration. So the very first person I wanted to thank for sponsoring this event is Sister Sally Duffy. And Sister, if you could raise your hand. She's from the SC Ministry Foundation. And Sister Sally has been supporting this work and this gathering for 3 years now, and I couldn't be more grateful for her steadfast support and for her guidance. I also wanted to thank the three event co-sponsors this year. All of them are terrific agencies, all of them are great partners, and all of them are longtime friends. They're the Border Network for Human Rights, and the Border Network is really well represented here tonight, so it's great to have you. This actually isn't an old friend, this is a new friend, because it was an agency that's just created, but the Hope Border Institute and Dylan Corbett and his team. And then a very old and valued friend, the Catholic Campaign for Human Development, and Ralph McLeod is here. And thanks as well to the leaders and experts from Catholic institutions from throughout the country who advise us and guide this project and have joined us for these 3 days. My particular thanks too to my own board members, the CMS board members who are here for this gathering. And we've already introduced Ralph McLeod from Catholic Campaign, and then Professor Manuel Vasquez from the University of Florida. He chairs our project's working group that brings together pastoral agents and academic research people, the research community. And there's Professor Vasquez over there, so thank you, Manuel. And another board member, Linda Hartke, who's the executive director. She's right here. Of Immigrant, Immigration, and Refugee Services. We want this project to be more ecumenical, and LIRS, or Lutheran Immigration, has been a valued partner agency to many of us, and we can certainly learn a lot from the Lutheran Network this year and in subsequent years. And last but not least, I wanted to thank the bishops who are here, Bishop Oscar Cantu from the Diocese of Las Cruces, Bishop Jose Guadalupe Torres Campos from the Diocese of Juarez. Thank you. And Bishop Mark Seitz from our host Diocese of El Paso. Very popular Bishop Seitz. And we're really grateful to have you here and grateful that you're here with us tonight, so thank you. We think that when we were thinking about doing this event, we thought, what would be an ideal site for this gathering? And El Paso is the perfect place for it, right? For a couple of reasons. First, because it's the border. It's the place where immigration happens. And second, because there are so many powerful and inspiring ministers and ministries and programs here. To me, this has always been the place of encounter. The Holy Father mentioned the importance of a culture of encounter. This is where encounter takes place every day. And there's lots of sacred places and great and inspired people here. It always renews me to be in El Paso. So we're really, really happy to be with you tonight in these next couple of days. Let me talk really briefly about what the Catholic Immigrant Integration Initiative is about, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about the Holy Father's visit, and then I'll introduce Hosffman. The purpose of this initiative is to understand, strengthen, and expand the work of diverse Catholic institutions and other faith-based institutions with immigrants, their work with immigrants and immigrant communities. And our guiding insight is that immigrants need Catholic institutions, and these institutions need immigrants who are playing an important role in revitalizing the Catholic Church in the United States and can play an even more substantial role. The initiative has five main goals. First, we study and we document the work of Catholic and other faith-based institutions with immigrants. That's far more challenging than it sounds because it's very extensive work. Second, we identify and disseminate model initiatives and ministries that promote immigrant integration, well-being, and empowerment. We documented several superb programs and ministries in our book on Catholic institutions, and we're systematically documenting successful programs now. We've also hosted events on programs that we think ought to be spread throughout the country and replicated, like the Archdiocese of Chicago's Pastoral Migratoria program, which is run by Elena Segura, who is here tonight, and on important research on Catholic institutions, like Brett Hoover's book on shared parishes, and Brett is here with us today as well. The third thing we do is we dialogue on how to evaluate the success of all of the work in this area. This is another complex issue, and we're going to be talking about that tomorrow. And fourth, we articulate the theological vision that underlies all of this work, and this is what Paulson is going to be doing for us in just a bit. And fifth, what we're trying to do is we're trying to create and grow a community of leaders who understand the importance of this work, are committed to its goals, and want to contribute to it moving forward. We think that all of these goals are related. If the underlying vision of what we're trying to accomplish is clear and compelling, and effective models are well known, and metrics are clear, then more good work will follow. In other words, the work of the institutions will be strengthened and expanded, which is our underlying goal. Probably the best way to describe what we're about, what we're trying to accomplish, is to let Pope Francis do it, right? And if any of us needed to be convinced about the life-giving importance of this work and the need to do more and better work, the Holy Father made the case for us this last week. Wasn't that a phenomenal week that we had? I'm just so thrilled. So I think you can never really go wrong in quoting Pope Francis. So let me do that. He said that we needed to see refugees and immigrants, quote, as persons, seeing their faces and listening to their stories, trying to respond as best we can to their situations, to respond in a way which is always humane, just, and fraternal. We need to avoid a common temptation nowadays to discard whatever proves troublesome. He also urged us, when it comes to migrants, to remember the golden rule, and that was a very powerful message. He said, this rule points us in a clear direction. Let us treat others with the same passion and compassion with which we want to be treated. Let us seek for others the same possibilities which we seek for ourselves. Let us help others to grow as we would like to be helped ourselves. In a word, if we want security, let us give security. If we want life, let us give life. If we want opportunities, let us provide opportunities. and he particularly lauded the work of church institutions on immigrant integration, which was remarkable. He said, "I'm aware of the immense efforts you've made to welcome and integrate immigrants who continue to look to America like so many others before them in the hope of enjoying the blessings of freedom and prosperity. I also appreciate the efforts which you are making to fulfill the church's mission of education, schools at every level, and in the charitable services offered by your numerous institutions. These works are often carried out without appreciation or support, often with heroic sacrifice, out of obedience to a divine mandate which we may not disobey." And he also explicitly appealed to communion. And communion is the concept which underlies all of our work with integration. And he reminded us that building unity across every barrier is central to the Catholic Church's mission. And he said, "May the forthcoming Holy Year of Mercy, by drawing us into the fathomless depth of God's heart, in which no division dwells, be for all of you a privileged moment for strengthening communion, perfecting unity, reconciling differences, forgiving one another, and healing every rift, that your light may shine forth like a city built on a hill." He urged us to carry forth the legacy of the past, not just by focusing on our old institutions, but above all, by being open to the possibilities which the Spirit opens to us. And he spoke of a deeper and a different metric of success than efficiency, good management, and outward success. "We've been entrusted with a great responsibility," he said, "and God's people rightly expect accountability from us. But the true worth of our apostolate is measured by the value it has in God's eyes. To see and evaluate things from God's perspective calls for constant conversion. In the first days and years of our vocations, and need I say, it also requires great humility. The cross shows us a different way of measuring success. Ours is to plant the seeds. God sees to the fruits of our labors. Our initiative has tried to highlight the central importance of human agency, development, and dignity, immigrant integration, and well-being and empowerment." And in his address to the UN General Assembly, no less, the Holy Father reminded us that integral human development and human dignity can never be imposed. In Philadelphia, he repeated to us the questions that Pope Leo XIII posed to St. Catherine Drexel. "What about you? What are you going to do?" These are questions we've been asking ourselves and our institutions in a lot of ways, including through this project. And he spoke to the need for openness to the gifts of all, the need for discerning and employing wisely the manifold gifts which the Spirit pours forth upon the church. And immigrants, of course, are one of those gifts. And he also praised the immense contribution which women, lay and religious, have made and continue to make to the life of our communities. This has been particularly true, this contribution has been particularly powerful in immigrant communities. And he repeatedly paid tribute to families and laborers and expressed concern about youth. The Holy Father has framed our time together very well for us. "See the human face, follow the golden rule, welcome and integrate, build unity across every barrier, strengthen communion, be open to the gifts of the Spirit, plant seeds, trust God, empower, don't impose, collaborate, and prioritize youth, families, and laborers." So these are our marching orders, and it's what we're trying to accomplish these next few days and with this project. Let me introduce now my friend Hosffman Ospino, who will be delivering the first annual Lydio F. Tomasi lecture. And this lecture was established last year by the CMS Board of Trustees through a generous contribution from the Rotondaro Family Fund. Each year, the lecturer is going to address a migration-related theme that's particularly important to faith communities. The series obviously honors Father Lydio Tomasi, who's a Scalabrini priest who founded CMS with his brother, Archbishop Silvano Tomasi, 51 years ago. And Father Lydio Tomasi led the agency for 33 years. And as I said, the Scalabrinian charism is to serve and to love migrants. And I wanted to say we're fortunate to have a Scalabrini priest with us today, and just wanted to do a shout out to him as well. And that's Father Patrick Murphy, who runs the Casa del Migrante in Tijuana. And Father, if you could just, because he's the representative of the Scalabrini. He certainly lived the charism for all of these years. Father Lydio Tomasi, who's been a great champion of migrants for his entire priesthood, I attended his 50th anniversary as a priest a couple of years ago, and in his homily, Cardinal McCarrick said that when he died, he planned to tell St. Peter at Heaven's Gates that he had done half as much for migrants as Father Lydio Tomasi had done. And he thought that that would be the best way to lead to his quick admission into heaven. So that's high praise. Professor Ospino is assistant professor of theology and education and director of the graduate programs in Hispanic Ministry at Boston College. He's a scholar who knows as much about Catholic parishes and Hispanic ministry as anybody. He's also an immigrant from Colombia. He holds a master's in theology with a concentration in church history and a doctorate in theology and education from Boston College. He was the principal investigator for the National Study of Catholic Parishes with Hispanic Ministry and co-principal investigator for the National Survey of Catholic Schools Serving Hispanic Families. And right now he's working on two books, one on Catholic multicultural congregations and the other on the Hispanic Catholic experience. He's also, as if that wouldn't keep you busy enough, he's also an officer of the Academy of Catholic Hispanic Theologians of the United States, and he's a father of a four-year-old and a two-year-old, so he's taking the night off tonight. Unfortunately, Father Lydio couldn't join us tonight, but I can tell you that he was thrilled to learn that Professor Ospino would be delivering his inaugural address, as we all are, and I'd ask Paso to come forward now.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much, Don, for the invitation to deliver this first lecture, the Lydio Tomasi lecture. I want to thank the bishops for your presence here in Bishop Sides for welcoming us here in El Paso, and also to all of you for the incredible work that you do for our immigrant sisters and brothers, not only here in El Paso, but also throughout the United States, and for supporting organizations that are invested in making and welcoming the immigrant or sisters and brothers who come to the United States to build the church. I have entitled my presentation tonight, my lecture, Immigration and Communion, Building American Catholicism in the 21st Century. What an exciting moment to be a Catholic in the United States of America today. The source of excitement comes certainly from the many challenges that we face together as a church, because they serve as clear tests to our Christian identity, witness, and commitment. But perhaps the most powerful source of excitement is the fact that we find ourselves in our day involved under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, who leads us through the confines of history in the process of fashioning a new moment in the history of American Catholicism. This fashioning is a true moment of creation and rebirth, a kairos in which we are invited to experience anew God's salvation in Jesus Christ, here and now. A time to affirm the best of who we are and open ourselves to new horizons with a sense of trust in the God of life, who, faithful to the revealed promise, walks with us on our journey. Immigrant and US born, young and old, women and men, single and married, ordained, consecrated and lay, poor and rich. Catholics of all cultural traditions, races, ethnicities, and social locations find ourselves participating in the process of building and rebuilding our local the church in this country from the bottom up, particularly at the level of local communities. We did not have to start from zero. Thanks to earlier generations of immigrants and their descendants, thousands of Catholic parishes and schools were built throughout our geography. Many organizations and ecclesial movements emerged to support Catholic life, and networks of Catholic services, social services, were created to share with millions, Catholic and non-Catholic, the best of our resources and hopes as we recognize the face of Christ in them. Not all these sojourners became part of the American Catholic experience in the same way. For many, it was not a choice. Some found themselves as residents of a new nation when geographical borders were redrawn. Others were colonized. Others were brought by force when the evil of slavery roamed unbridled in our land. And others arrived as exiles. For many others, the United States was a chosen destiny, a land of dreams and opportunity. Millions of Catholic immigrants in the 19th and the 20th centuries from Europe and many other parts of the world made the United States of America their home. Despite their different stories, all these Catholics coincided in the same land. All shared the same faith in the Lord Jesus. All together were the church, and were tasked as Christian disciples to build the church in this corner of the world. Now we ask, what made it possible that despite the different historical, sociocultural, and ecclesial experiences that shaped the lives of these Catholics, now coinciding in the United States, Catholicism in this country did not fragment or become something else? Who were the Catholic structures built to serve, particularly parishes and schools? Whose needs were the Catholic organizations and networks that emerged to address first? The formulation of these three questions serves as an entry point into a series of thoughts that I would like to share with you tonight on the theological concept of ecclesial communion, and explore how this concept can be instrumental to affirm the contributions of the new generation of Catholic immigrants to the fashioning of the American Catholic experience in the 21st century. Building the church, building communion. The church is both a given reality and a project. To be more exact, is God's given reality in God's project. Its existence can only be fully understood from an eschatological perspective in which God is the beginning and the end. The church is the community of those called by God within the realm of history and beyond to experience the fullness of the mystery of divine love and salvation through Jesus Christ. The ecclesial community, in its historical existence, remains a project to be actualized and sustained at any given moment before the end of time. All the baptized, then, share the unique responsibility to remain faithful to the divine calling to be church and to build the church through witness and action throughout our lives. Such responsibility is sustained on the triple dynamic: vocation, witness, and mission. For Christians, this baptismal identity transcends in many ways the differences and particularities that shape our lives, whether in terms of language, race, ethnicity, social location, ideological positioning, and even migratory status. However, the term transcend here should not be read as a synonym of obliterate, which would be a serious misinterpretation. Grace builds upon nature, we are constantly reminded. Baptismal identity transcends the particularity of our lives in the sense that it becomes the interpreted framework to make sense of the quandaries of our daily existence, to understand ourselves as relational beings who are accountable to more than the whims of our individual selves, and to gradually discover that our lives have a purpose. Embracing our baptismal identity is at the very core of being church and building the church. Christian life is fundamentally about being in intimate relationship with God through Jesus Christ in the Holy Spirit. And in light of that existential dynamic, fundamentally about being in intimate relationship with others in history and beyond in the created order. This being in relationship with God, who is triune, others, and creation, is at the core of the Christian concept of communion. Much has been written about the theological meaning of communion in our days, particularly as Catholics continue to delve into the depths and richness of the Second Vatican Council. Of particular attention is the continuous reference to the dogmatic constitution on the Church, Lumen Gentium, which offers several key pointers to understanding an ecclesiology of communion. Three come to mind as we reflect on the contribution of Catholic immigrants to the constant process of building and rebuilding ecclesial communities in the United States. One, the Church is the people of God. The Church is willed by God from the beginning and is called into existence through the economy in Jesus Christ. Those who, with divine faith, accept Jesus Christ and the Church, his body, and through the waters of baptism participate in the paschal mystery of the Lord, are the Church. Lumen Gentium 9 reminds us. This was to be the new people of God. For those who believe in Christ, who are reborn, not from perishable, but from an imperishable seed, through the word of the living God, not from the flesh, but from the water and the Holy Spirit, are finally established as the chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a purchased people, who in times past were not a people, but now are the people of God. Baptized Catholics anywhere, anytime, regardless their differences, are the people of God. Two, ecclesial communion is fully expressed in the Church's universal character. The Catholicity or universality of the Church, and consequently membership in the community of those called by God to experience the saving mystery of Christ, cannot be restricted by exclusionary categories such as political affiliation or cultural background or even legal circumstance. Again, Lumen Gentium number 13 says, Though there are many nations, there is but one people of God, which takes its citizens from every race, making them citizens of a kingdom which is of a heavenly rather than of an earthly nature. All the faithful, scattered though they are be throughout the world, are in communion with each other and the Holy Spirit. Ecclesial communion, as a dynamic and profoundly spiritual category, escapes the entrapments of ideological reductionisms that purport understandings of Catholic identity as exclusionary, particularly within the same ecclesial community, and homogenizing, ignoring the values of diversity and difference that are essential to being human. 3. Ecclesial communion is profoundly Eucharistic. Catholics discover who we are in our communities are truly centers of authentic Catholic life when we celebrate and partake of the Eucharist. At the same time, the Eucharist builds the ecclesial community when the people of God is convoked to celebrate our faith, share it with one another, nourish our hearts and minds with the scriptures, receive the body and blood of Christ, and ultimately be sent out to give witness of who we are while journeying together as children of God. As Lumen Gentium affirms, quote, taking part in the Eucharistic sacrifice, which is the fount and apex of the whole Christian life, the faithful offer the divine victim to God and offer themselves along with it. Strengthening the Holy Communion by the body of Christ, they then manifest in a concrete way that unity of the people of God which is suitable, signified, and wondrously brought about by this most august sacrament. Close quote. A church building communion and for communion. Let us then return to the three questions formulated earlier. What made it possible that despite the different historical, sociocultural, and ecclesial experiences that shaped the lives of immigrants, journeying Catholics, now coinciding in the United States, Catholicism in this country did not fragment or become something different? 2, who were the Catholic structures built to serve? And 3, whose needs were the Catholic organizations and networks that emerged to address first? The reflection on the highlighted three characteristics of ecclesial communion as a theological concept has somehow paved the way to address these concepts or these questions. A close historical analysis of the experience of those groups that eventually shaped American Catholicism as we know it today indicates that an implied theology of communion was the ultimate glue that allowed for this experience to grow and thrive. A practical theology that embodied all three characteristics. The establishment of national and ethnic parishes throughout the country may have given the impression that Catholic unity was not possible. Towns and cities in the Northeast and the Midwest saw the erection of multiple Catholic churches just a few blocks from each other. Parishes serving Hispanic and Black and Asian Catholics in the South and the West of the country functioned as segregated entities for too long, and many continue to do so, without much relationship to those churches where white Euro-American Catholics worshipped. But a particular sense of communion, nevertheless, allowed them to be Catholic, to remain Catholic. Regardless of their country of origin, language, or socioeconomic status, Catholic immigrants found or built faith communities that would welcome them because these immigrants were the church. These were faith communities to which they belonged. Oases where they could drink from the fountains of sacramental grace and be nourished with the scriptures in their own languages through familiar rituals while still imbued in their own cultural traditions. They were welcomed into these communities, functioning as separate units still, for who they were, namely baptized Catholics, but they knew that they participated of something universal and larger than these small separate communities. Week after week, they gathered to celebrate and partake of the Eucharist, and often the celebration of other sacraments, where they were convoked, instructed, nourished, and sent. Even the small attempts to consider national churches, which meant separating from the larger Catholic communion, either never materialized or never gained momentum. As the immigrant generation passed, their children and grandchildren became more assimilated into the larger culture. National churches had fulfilled their purpose and yielded to more mainstream experiences of being parish, thus giving rise to a more standard way of living the American Catholic experience, which still prevails in many parts of the country to this day. But not everything has been perfect. Of course, since many areas remain to be addressed in many of our faith communities, including racial biases, classism, and even harmful ideological polarization that often divides families and parishes. Yet, one thing was certain. American Catholics were harvesting the fruits of the implied theology of communion, ecclesiology of communion to be more exact, that is easier for us to identify many years later. They were the church. Their parents and grandparents have built the church in communion and for communion. What made possible that American Catholicism, as shaped by the millions of immigrant Catholics from the first wave, whose lives were shaped by different historical, sociocultural, and ecclesial experiences, did not fragment or become something different, was a strong desire to be and to build church. To be and to build church. They built a large number of structures, Catholic parishes and schools, among many others, to serve Catholics, particularly families and the young. The many organizations and networks that they saw emerging in time sought to address the spiritual, educational, ministerial, and pastoral needs of Catholics first. This did not mean that these Catholics had no regard for others who did not share the religious convictions or concern for the realities of the larger society. They did, and such engagement has evolved over the years, yet they took care of their own and wanted a strong church. American Catholics in the 21st century have a unique opportunity to continue to be and to build, and in some places, rebuild the church in this corner of the world. Catholic immigrants today are to play a major role once again. The majority of these immigrants, this time, does not come from Europe, but from Latin America, Asia, and the So the majority the majority of these immigrants this time does not come from Europe, but from Latin America, Asia, and the Caribbean, with a growing number from Africa and the Middle East. It is the second wave, as Adam Figueroa has wisely observed. Catholic migration from Latin America, Asia, and the Caribbean is not new, since we have experienced it already for several decades in our own faith communities. Just as the immigrants from yesterday, the immigrants from today arrive with the hope of a new and better life and are often encouraged by their faith convictions. This time, the new immigrant Catholic wave finds a church in the United States with a relatively long history. Thousands of parishes and schools, hundreds of organizations and networks built and established over the decades are seemingly ready to welcome them and support them not only with their spiritual and pastoral, but also their human and social needs. Are they? The three questions that we formulated earlier must be asked once again in our day, although with some nuances. Is it possible that the new historical, sociocultural, and ecclesial experiences that shape the lives of immigrant Catholics today will find a home in the already established embodiments of American Catholicism, minimizing the risk that those experiences become marginalized or reduced to a permanent life in the peripheries of our faith communities? Are the structures, for instance, parishes, schools, universities, that Catholics built over the years and the many resources that allowed large numbers of Catholic women and men of all ages to grow in their Catholic identity, are these serving the new wave of Catholic immigrants and their children? Are our Catholic organizations and networks placing the needs of the new wave of Catholic immigrants and their children first? The answer to these questions calls for some serious soul searching at all levels in the life of the Church. At stake, my dear friends, is the forging of a strong experience of Church in the 21st century, one that builds on the sense of ecclesial communion that already exists, because we do not have to start as blank slates. And it incorporates the multiple experiences of ecclesial life that Catholic immigrants bring from their countries of origin, as well as those that are being nurtured, particularly in thousands of shared parishes throughout the United States. The markers of communion for the new immigrant church are very clear to us, since we have the privilege of drawing directly from the Second Vatican Council and the many reflections on ecclesial communion during the last 50 years. First, the new Catholic immigrants and their children are also the people of God. Welcoming and embracing them in our communities is not an option. It is the Church welcoming the Church. Two, the diversity of cultural and religious experiences that immigrant Catholics and their descendants bring to our faith communities are an expression of the universality of our Church. These experiences enrich American Catholicism and make it stronger. Third, it is the celebration of the Eucharist, the source and summit of the whole Christian life, where all Catholics, immigrants and U.S. born, documented and undocumented, find ourselves together, convoked, instructed, nourished and sent as members of the same Catholic family, children of the same God, disciples of the same Lord Jesus Christ, and heirs of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Keeping in mind this last point, it is important to make a key observation. Given the decline in the number of clergy, the closing of parishes in some parts of the country, and the insufficient number of parishes in the places where Catholicism is growing most vibrantly, thanks to the presence of immigrants and that of their children and grandchildren, the most important question is not in what language should we celebrate the Eucharist, but who is going to celebrate it, and where will the people of God gather to do so? All signs point to the good news that Hispanic, Asian, Caribbean, and Black immigrant Catholics, among many others, and their descendants, want to be church and want to build a church in the United States. However, without a clear ecclesiology of communion that embraces the new immigrant experience and allows our church to be challenged by the same experience, we may simply miss our opportunity. An ecclesiology of communion for our Catholic communities must presently be grounded in the conviction that we need to be communities of faith, families, parishes, schools, organizations, where we are constantly welcoming one another and together decide to build the church of today while planting the seeds of the church tomorrow. Allow me to conclude with a thought I recently wrote on the relationship between immigration and the theological virtue of hope, which in many ways captures what I have shared in this point, captures to this point regarding communion. The Catholic Church in the United States has always been an immigrant church, although awareness of the immigrant identity has not always been at the forefront of our shared historical consciousness. Today it is. U.S. Catholicism is being renewed and profoundly transformed by immigrants from all over the world, particularly from Latin America. As immigrants settle in society and in the church, a new set of hopes arise. My sense is that the ultimate hope for community, an authentic Christian community, becomes actualized in a twofold hopeful desire that has much to do with how we understand ourselves in relationship with God. On the one hand, the immigrant desires to be part of the community, not as a stranger or a visitor, but as a member, someone whose presence is sincerely appreciated and embraced, someone without whom the community would be incomplete. On the other hand, because the community desires to grow as a body of witnesses of God's love in Jesus Christ, immigrants not only are welcome into this vision, but also are responsible for making such a vision real. The ultimate hope of the immigrant for community, and the ultimate hope of the community to become what is called to be, are one and the same in a spirit of faithful mutuality guided by God's Holy Spirit. Both hopes, in the end, are expressions of the desire to allow God's reign to become truly present here and now. Both hopes, my sisters and brothers, are nothing else but powerful longings for communion. Thank you.
Dylan, can we ask you to come up and the three bishops, please?
Good evening again, everybody. Buenas noches a todas y a todos. Before we begin our proceedings tomorrow for this very important meeting, for which many of you have come from different parts of the country, we wanted a word of encouragement, a word of hope, a word of what Pope Francis would call parresia, frank speech from our pastors, from our bishops. And that's what for us right now. My name is Dylan Corbett, and I'm the executive director of the Hope Water Institute, El Instituto Fronterizo Esperanza, one of the co-sponsoring organizations of the events of these days. Allow me to give you a warm welcome to our border community. I'll have more chance to talk about HBI in our work tomorrow, but let me just say right now that we work, our mission is to work at the intersection of faith, Catholic social teaching, policy, community, and building a better future for all our border residents on both sides of the border. During his trip to the United States last week, Pope Francis hit again and again on the concepts of encuentro and diálogo. And our mission principally is to put that into practice here in our border community. We work very closely with the Catholic Church, including with each of the speakers tonight, Bishop Cantu, Bishop Flores Campos, and Bishop Seitz. Because we work in community organizing and building community, sometimes we can have some trouble because that's a concept that's sometimes difficult to talk about with people of faith and faith leaders. So let me briefly, before I introduce our speakers, explain that topic by way of an anecdote from Pope Francis. Shortly after Pope Francis was elected, there was a debate that was scheduled between the Pope Francis and the chief rabbi of Rome, because both of them were new to Rome. They were both new to their positions. And so the debate was scheduled on the bridge over the river that flows through Rome on the other side of the Vatican. And the two faith leaders, the Pope and the rabbi, met in the middle of the bridge for the debate, for the diálogo and encuentro. But the problem was that the new chief rabbi of Rome only spoke English and Yiddish, and Pope Francis only spoke Spanish and a little bit of Latin. And so it wasn't clear what language they would speak in, and so they decided beforehand that they would have the debate in silence, using only hand signals. So the two men, the two faith leaders, left in the middle of the bridge, and the first thing the Pope did was hold up three fingers. And the chief rabbi held up one finger. And then the Pope kind of did this over his head. And the chief rabbi pointed to the ground vigorously. And then the Pope took up the instruments of the Holy Mass, the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, the bread, the chalice, and wine. And the rabbi took out an apple. And Pope Francis, very uncharacteristically, because he's such a nice and gentle man, went off in a huff and puff back to the Vatican, back to Casa Santa Marta, where he lives, and got in line in the cafeteria line like he does every day at the hotel for lunch. And the people ran to Pope Francis, Papa Francisco, what happened? ¿Qué pasó? Y él dijo, muy enojado. He said, pues, the rabbi beat me. For everything I said, he had a better answer. First I said, God is three, Padre, Hijo, Espíritu Santo. And the rabbi said, no, God is one. And then I said, God is transcendent. God is so much more. I'm a Jesuit, Inter Mayor. And the chief rabbi said, no, God is here with us. He's present. And then the Pope says, and then I talked about how we've all been redeemed by the blood of Christ, which we celebrate in the Holy Eucharist, and so I showed him the bread and wine of the Mass. And he showed me an apple, reminding me that we're all touched by original sin, todavía. Now on the other side of the river, the chief rabbi was at the synagogue talking to all of his congregants, and they said, what happened? What happened? And the rabbi said, I don't know. The Pope first told me, you have 3 days to all get out of Rome. And I said, we're staying right here. And then he said, we're going to round you all up. He said, we're not going anywhere. And then what happened? And then what happened, Rabbi? He said, well, I don't know. He took out his lunch and I took out mine. We need spaces of diálogo and encuentro for the conversations and the language and the common vocabulary. Places where we can recognize our common dignity. The church is one of those places. And the pastors, the bishops that we've invited tonight, are great at reminding the church, calling it to its vocation of being that place of diálogo and encuentro. Let me present them. Bishop Monsignor Jose Guadalupe Torres Campos is the Bishop of Ciudad Juarez, our sister diocese just down the road. Pope Francis recently said talking about that throwaway culture he often talks about. We've created a throwaway culture no longer simply about exploitation and oppression, but something new, exclusion. Exclusion which has to do with what it means to be part of the society in which we live, where the excluded are no longer society's underside, or its fringes, or its disenfranchised. The excluded are not the exploited, but outcast and leftovers. He could have been thinking about Ciudad Juarez in the last couple of years, which has witnessed violence. So many people sacrificed on the altar of greed, the drug war, violence, the globalization of indifference, the globalization of inequality, the globalization of inequity. Bishop Torres Campos is presiding very courageously over what we pray is the rebirth of Ciudad Juarez, socially, spiritually, religious. And he's made the church's commitment to human dignity a central pillar of his ministry as the new bishop there. If you're not familiar with our second bishop, Bishop Gandu, personally, he's affable, approachable, and humble. You certainly know him by his work. Bishop Oscar Gandu of the Diocese of Las Cruces leads the bishops of the United States, the whole country, in their work to promote peace and justice around the world. Whether it is called to protect the safety net for those in poverty, or his recent call during a trip to Japan to abolish nuclear weapons, or his tireless encouraging, cajoling, and exhorting the President and the Congress to pursue the path of encuentro, diálogo, and negotiations with Iran, or standing up with the people in the Diocese of Las Cruces to welcome the Central American child and mother refugees, demonstrating them the love of Christ the Good Shepherd. Bishop Gandu has proven himself to be a powerful and effective advocate for justice, peace, and the reign of God. And finally, our host tonight as the bishop of this diocese, Bishop Mark Seitz, was a proven pastor, a shepherd, a leader, and an advocate for the migrant, for the poor, and for the unborn. He's demonstrated national leadership on the national stage by advocating for the rights of migrants, for refugees, for asylum seekers. He's having done so before very hostile congressional committees in Washington, D.C. We want to welcome Bishop Seitz and all our bishops tonight, and I ask them to offer us greater encouragement as we go into tomorrow's proceedings. Welcome, bishops. Bishop Seitz, if I could offer you, ask you to begin our presentation.
Good evening, everyone. You know, it's interesting to be asked to speak about the integration of immigrants in El Paso. That's a question I was posed. I'm wondering whether it might be more appropriate here to speak about the integration of non-immigrants. In effect, we are a city of immigrants, no? Los inmigrantes son la mayor parte de esta comunidad. I took a look at some of the statistics. It tells me that 45 years ago, in 1970, non-Hispanic whites, Anglos, made up more than 40% of the population here in El Paso. That probably made them the largest group in the city 45 years ago. Now, that number in 2015 is of non-Hispanic whites is closer to 12%. More than 80% of the population here in El Paso are Hispanic. And I guess that probably 70% of the people who live here speak at least some Spanish, and really a very high percentage are bilingual. It's just amazing as you carry on conversations here, you know, and find them going back and forth all the time between English and Spanish, even in the same sentence. When violence became a very serious problem in Juarez around 2008, there was a large migration of families to El Paso from there. I've heard estimates of something like 15 to 20,000 people who came here with documents to live in El Paso. God knows how many fled here without documents. We are a city that lives really, even though we have that tremendous maya, that fence in between us now, we still live with one foot on one side of the border and one foot on the other, no? We have schools where well over half of the students come from Juarez. And we have many people from here in El Paso who will go across to Juarez to work. We still manage to live on both sides of the border, despite the obstacles. All of this is just to say that ministry to immigrants here is not ministry to some small select group. Our ministry is ministry to and with migrants. That's what we do here in El Paso. We're serving recent immigrants, or we're serving first generation people who have come here. Within that group that we call migrants, of course, there is a great diversity. There are people of varying education levels and various economic levels, a breadth of cultural experiences, although the vast majority of the people who have relocated here are from Mexico. Still within Mexico, as you are well aware, there is still a great breadth of experience. We need to make sure that, of course, we're serving all of them. Now, we're well aware that this issue of immigration is not simply a local issue. But we, here in El Paso, and in this region, in all humility, I can think we can say we are the experts on this issue of migration. Don't you think? Yeah, we know it. We live it every day. And we hear some of the people who don't live anywhere close to here expressing their opinions about what's happening on the border. And we say, what are they talking about? They don't seem to have a clue. So we find in our experience here a certain responsibility. We have a responsibility to share what we know about immigrants, about the integration of immigrants into the culture, about the richness of their presence and their contribution to our life here, to the fact that an immigrant here in El Paso doesn't need to remain a they, an other. They very quickly become a we, a part of our community. Something else we know is that we need to work together. This is true of every kind of entity, but it's a particular responsibility of the church. And that's why Bishop Cantu and Bishop Campos Torres Campos I have attempted to really form lines of communication and ways that we can work together in the name of the church, because this is not simply a local issue. We also, I don't know if you're aware, we have an organization of bishops from both sides of the border. It has a good name. It's the Tex-Mex Bishops. And we gather two times every year in order to meet and talk about the issues that we face, and obviously the questions of serving those who are migrating is a major topic of our gatherings. It's a wonderful group of bishops that are very committed to serving better our community. We've issued a number of pastoral letters that at least one of which was picked up by the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops and disseminated about serving immigrant families. So certainly, you know, in every area of ministry there is much more to do than we can or are accomplishing. We can see great tasks ahead of us, but one thing that I'm convinced about in my time here in El Paso is that if we're going to find healthy ways of responding to the presence of immigrants in our country and totally integrating this treasure that is now in our midst, we're going to learn a lot about it from this region of the country. El Paso va a estar un paso para todos. Gracias.
Buenas tardes. Apenas tengo 7 meses que llegué a esta diócesis. La diócesis grande, importante, para el norte de la República de México. Cuentan los mayores que hace más de 50 años los locales de Ciudad Juárez prácticamente se ubicaba la ciudad como una ciudad, valga la expresión, con todo respeto, grandísimo, cantinas, bares. Pero hace 40 años para acá comienza el boom de las maquiladoras. Y es entonces cuando Ciudad Juárez se convierte en una ciudad industrial, donde vienen personas de toda la República en busca de trabajo. Tal vez queriendo llegar a los Estados Unidos, encuentran trabajo en Ciudad Juárez. De tal manera que la ciudad se convierte en casa de muchos. En Juárez vivimos gente de toda la República. Yo pregunto cuando veo las parroquias, ¿dónde eres? De Oaxaca, de Torreón, de todas partes. Es una ciudad como un mosaico cultural. Por eso decir con toda seguridad que Ciudad Juárez es una ciudad hermosa, maravillosa, que acoge con los brazos abiertos a todos. Gracias por invitarme a participar en esta hermosa reunión y compartir con ustedes algunas palabras acerca de lo que la diócesis de Ciudad Juárez hace con relación, ya más concretamente, en este punto de los migrantes. En los años 80, Surge la experiencia de la migración con los hermanos escalabrinianos, con la experiencia de los braceros y agricultores, entre otros. Terminando su presencia, su misión, en el 2004. La misión migratoria la continúan los padres dominicos y ellos terminan en el 2010. Retomando esta pastoral de migrantes, los sacerdotes diocesanos, desde el 2010 hasta el día de hoy. La Casa del Migrante fue reconocida jurídicamente en 1993, es decir, como una asociación civil, 22 años lleva. Pero su gran labor es de 30 años. ¿Cuál es la misión de la Casa del Migrante? Acoger a todo ser humano sin distinción que llegue a nuestro albergue, reconociendo en él a un ser humano que es hijo e hija de Dios. Que sientan ese calor de hogar y de familia que ha dejado al iniciar su caminar como migrantes. Es Dios quien a través de su iglesia acoge a sus hijos e hijas migrantes. Como nos dice el documento de Aparecida, el capítulo 8. El reino de Dios es promoción de la dignidad humana. ¿Cómo se realiza esta misión? El edificio, nuestro albergue, tiene la capacidad de recibir a 200 migrantes, con áreas para niños, familias, hombres, mujeres, enfermos, o casos especiales como desplazados, refugiados, o los que vienen huyendo de muerte y piden asilo político, problema de trata, enfermos de hepatitis, tuberculosis o sida, o alguna otra enfermedad, o bien casos de secuestros u otros abusos a personas en nuestro país o extranjero, que le pide alguna autoridad de gobierno o institución civil. Algunas áreas de trabajo para describir la Casa del Migrante. Tenemos una recepción, trabajo social, jurídico, juegos, televisión, áreas verdes, gimnasio, cocina, almuerzo, comida y cena, capilla, baños y regaderas, teléfonos, computación, enfermería, áreas de camas para cada tipo de migrantes, salón de formación, educación, para lavar su ropa, como otras de talleres, de lectura, dibujo, etc. Tenemos un centro de derechos humanos, tiene como finalidad dar seguimiento a los problemas de los y las migrantes, problemas legales, familiares, de papelería, regulación, defensa, sobre todo el trabajo en red con las oficinas de derechos humanos local, estatal y federal, para lograr defender al migrante en todos los aspectos posibles de los cuales son víctimas de abusos. ¿Quién y cuánto tiempo están ahí en el albergue? El albergue está abierto las 24 horas del día, de los 7 días de la semana. Hay un total de personal de 21 personas, con turnos de mañana, tarde y noche, todos como empleados. En el 2013 se atendieron 4.976 migrantes. En el 2014 se atendieron 6.456 migrantes. Este año 2015 hasta este mes de septiembre, 4.898 migrantes. grandes o niños, adolescentes, jóvenes, adultos y ancianos, y familias enteras. Tiempo de estancia en nuestro albergue, por norma general, son 3 días, pero hay excepciones según sea el caso de cada migrante. Por ejemplo, los centroamericanos tienen derecho a 15 días, cuando son de algún estado de violencia como Michoacán, 15 días, o están como asilo político hasta meses, según cada caso. ¿Qué tipo de personas llegan, migrantes, llegan a la casa? En primer lugar son nuestros hermanos centroamericanos, particularmente de Honduras, Guatemala y El Salvador. El segundo tipo de personas son los deportados de Estados Unidos a México. En tercer lugar, la migración interna de nuestro país, Michoacán, Tamaulipas, Guerrero, Oaxaca, Chiapas, Veracruz, entre otros. Sobre todo los estados con más violencia. Claro que será de muchos otros estados o ciudades de nuestro país, incluyendo el mismo estado de Chihuahua. Es importante mencionar también que hermanos de Cuba, de Ecuador, de Puerto Rico, de Canadá, España, Francia e India. Muy poco, pero sí han llegado a nuestro albergue. Otra realidad de migración que recibimos son los migrantes de tránsito, circuito como los jóvenes, desplazados, refugiados, muchos de ellos huyendo de la violencia o de la pobreza, del narcotráfico, los que vienen a arreglar algún trámite de migración, ya sean de Estados Unidos o México, o casos especiales de alguna institución de gobierno, del consulado mexicano, departamento de fiscalía, de la PGR, Policía General Regional, Policía Municipal, de parroquias, etc. ¿Qué porcentajes de migrantes recibimos al año? Del 100% del total de nuestros migrantes, adultos hombres, 50%. Adultos mujeres, 25%. Familias enteras, 10%. Niños, adolescentes o jóvenes, 15%. ¿Con cuáles instancias o dependencias se trabaja para realizar esta misión? Con el gobierno, Consulado de México en El Paso, Texas, Instituto Nacional de Migración, Presidencia Municipal, el DIF Estatal, Policía Municipal, Gobierno del Estado, Relaciones Exteriores y otras. También con asociaciones civiles, Casa Inca, Derechos Humanos Municipal, Estatal y Nacional. También nos ayudan farmacias como la CIMI y otros albergues afines a nuestra misión. Como Iglesia Católica tenemos encuentros nacionales, internacionales y provinciales de la pastoral de movilidad humana para trabajar y promover la comunión con los 65 albergues, centros de atención al migrante en nuestro país, celebrando jornadas de migrantes y refugiados. También trabajamos como Iglesia Binacional, ya lo dijo nuestro querido obispo Mar, celebraciones de misa de migrantes y juntos en la Maya, en la Napra, y otras celebraciones o trabajos en conjunto. ¿Cómo se sostiene económicamente la Casa del Migrante? Nuestro albergue se ha sostenido de la caridad. con un patronato y algunos bienhechores. Reconocemos que hace 3 años el gobierno federal y estatal está ayudando. Algunos retos que sentimos que son urgentes y que hay que atender. El fuerte abuso de las autoridades mexicanas a los y las migrantes centroamericanos y sus derechos fundamentales como personas. Mucha falta de interés por parte del gobierno por el problema de migración, ya sea en los deportados y en la migración interna de nuestro país y más de los centroamericanos. La migración de niños o adolescentes y jóvenes, acompañados o no, pues ellos son los más vulnerables. La falta de servicios para los migrantes, como es tener derecho a la salud. Se batalla mucho para recibir y atender a los enfermos migrantes, muchas veces con enfermedades muy críticas. La fuerte lucha contra el narcotráfico, en los secuestros, extorsiones a los y las migrantes, incluso hasta su familia. Los abusos que sufren los y las migrantes en la cárcel o centros de detención, ya sea por los agentes o algunas personas, violaciones a su persona, humillaciones, golpes y despojo de sus pertenencias o bienes que ya tenían. Las estrategias de separación de las familias o parejas de Estados Unidos, una pareja deportada por una frontera y la otra por otra frontera muy lejos, para que no se encuentren fácil con las deportaciones aéreas. Los centros de detención de los niños y niñas, tanto acompañados por un familiar como los que van solos, están en Estados Unidos. Promoción de la sociedad, de la realidad de la migración, que no es un mal, sino una oportunidad de muchos hombres y mujeres y familias que quieren una mejor vida. Esto es una oportunidad de concientización a la no discriminación a los y las migrantes. Más o menos esa es la realidad que como diócesis vivimos de México, que sí nos pone en una actitud de estar atentos, como nos está pidiendo el Papa Francisco, para salir al encuentro de ellos, recibirlos, atenderlos, amarlos y ayudarles, servirles. Por eso es muy importante este congreso, esta reunión, para sensibilizarnos de esta situación que, como digo al final, es una oportunidad que se nos presenta para servir y para atender a los más débiles, a los más desprotegidos, en este caso, nuestros hermanos y hermanas migrantes. Gracias.
Thank you again. We've been sitting here for a good while, and we've had a nice meal. Some of us had a glass of wine, and so ya es tiempo para la mimi. Pero así que pienso ser breve, y ojalá todo esto sea para nuestro beneficio. Sí les gustó eso, ¿verdad? La experiencia que tuvimos el verano pasado aquí en la frontera, todos lo recordamos, miles de niños que llegaron a la frontera desde Centroamérica, muchas mamás solas con sus hijos, huyendo la violencia, huyendo situaciones muy difíciles en sus hogares, y buscando encontrarse de nuevo con el resto de sus familiares, que muchos que ya estaban aquí en Estados Unidos. Me impresionó mucho aquí que se nos pidió el gobierno a la iglesia que abriéramos las puertas para recibir a esas personas para, por un tiempo, para darles comida, para darles asilo, para darles hospitalidad mientras que se vayan preparando a encontrarse con sus familiares. El obispo Sykes aquí abrió generosamente las puertas de la iglesia. Se me pidió también en mi diócesis, en Las Cruces, abrir las puertas. Yo me quedé muy impresionado con la generosidad de la comunidad en Las Cruces. Personas católicas, personas no católicas, personas no cristianas abrieron el corazón y recibieron a estos niños, a estas mamás con sus hijos, para darles hospitalidad. Fue impresionante, y fue porque reconocieron que estas personas son seres humanos y cada ser humano tiene dignidad, creado a la imagen y semejanza de Dios. Así, a mí me dio mucho orgullo ser parte de ese esfuerzo, pero también sentí mucha frustración escuchar el debate que se tuvo a través de Estados Unidos. El debate fue: ¿cómo podemos cerrar las fronteras? Porque obviamente no están suficientemente cerradas. Y la frustración era de que no se veía más allá de ese debate, que era un debate político. Porque nunca se preguntó en ese debate nacional, ¿por qué vienen estos jóvenes? ¿Por qué vienen estas mamás con niños pequeños, poniendo en riesgo sus familias, sus vidas, su seguridad? Y no hacían esa pregunta porque al fin y al cabo nos implica a nosotros. Ellos vienen huyendo el caos de sus comunidades afectadas por el tráfico de drogas. Y al fin y al cabo se tiene que hacer la pregunta: ¿por qué tanto droga? Nosotros en Estados Unidos, que somos los consumidores principales, entonces todo este problema nos implica a nosotros. De aquí voy hasta Asia. Se anunció que sirvo como presidente de la Comisión de los Obispos de la Paz y Justicia Internacional. Viajé este verano a la Asia. Entre los lugares que visité fue la nación de Malasia. Allí han llegado muchos refugiados de distintas partes de Asia, del Medio Oriente. Entre las visitas que hice durante ese tiempo, visité con varias señoras jóvenes que habían venido como refugiadas del Medio Oeste, algunas de Siria, otras de Palestina, otras de Irán y otras de Irak. Y tenían el problema
en que en Malasia no se les permitía conseguir un permiso para trabajar. Y es lo principal que querían esas personas, jóvenes, hábiles, y querían trabajar, y no se les permitía hacerlo legalmente. Entre ellas, unas 10 señoras que se reunieron con nosotros, los obispos, visitando con ellas, una que tenía doctorado en computadora y no podía trabajar. ¿Cuánto podía ella proveer a esa sociedad? Entonces, cuando pensamos en los migrantes, inmediatamente pensamos en los problemas. Tenemos que pensar en los dones que traen esos migrantes, con tanto deseo de trabajar, de aprender y de proveer. Entonces hay que levantar esa realidad. Algo el profesor habló de lo que es el círculo alrededor de la Eucaristía, que es la comunión eclesial. Y cómo nos tratamos como hermanos, porque sí somos hermanos en Cristo. Aunque hablemos distintos idiomas, pero la realidad es que no siempre nos encontramos con personas católicas o cristianas. En mi viajar a distintos lugares a través del mundo, muchas personas son musulmanes, son budistas, son personas sin religión oficial. ¿Y qué de ellos? Y algo que me ha impresionado mucho, una organización de parte de los obispos de Estados Unidos, Catholic Relief Services, es, por decir, la Caritas Internacional de parte de los obispos. Y el Catholic Relief Service, CRS, tiene un lema. El lema es este: los servimos a ustedes no porque ustedes sean católicos, sino porque nosotros somos católicos. Entonces reconocemos la dignidad humana en cada ser humano, y por eso levantamos esa dignidad. Quiero compartir brevemente la experiencia de mi familia. Yo, como hijo de migrantes, nacido en Houston, en Texas, de papás de México, de Monterrey. Mi papá, como se crió en el rancho, para él era pecado mortal desperdiciar la luz del sol. Entonces los sábados nos levantaba a nosotros, a mis 4 hermanos, a mis 3 hermanas y a mí, tempranito los sábados, para salir a trabajar, a limpiar la casa, limpiar el patio. Así que los muchachos afuera limpiando el patio, mis hermanas limpiando adentro de la casa y mi mamá preparando la comida. Y ahí pasábamos toda la mañana. Para mí no era pecado dormir los sábados. Para mí es lo que se hacía. Uno debería de dormir tarde los sábados y levantarse ya tarde para ver caricaturas. Pero a mi papá no le pareció. Bueno, pues ya terminados los quehaceres, nos juntábamos todos a comer un caldo de res bien sabroso que hacían ahí, y todos alrededor de la mesa con unas tortillas recién hechas, y ahí precedía mi papá en la mesa, y él comenzaba a contar los valores que dio a través de la vida, que eran valores de que él a veces desperdició. él que se había salido de la escuela a los 10 años porque no le gustaba estudiar, y su papá en aquel entonces le dijo, pues vente a la huerta a trabajar si no quieres estudiar. Y mi papá nos decía a nosotros, nos enseñaba sus manos bien trabajadas, decía, no cometan el error que yo cometí. Estudien. Y segundo nos decía, manténganse cerca de la iglesia, porque la iglesia es como una madre que nos nutre, que nos guía, que nos da valores en la vida. Esos dos valores principales que aprendimos alrededor de la misa, la educación y la fe. Y ojalá que esos valores se sigan inculcando en nuestros hogares. Una palabra para terminar de mi diócesis. Mi diócesis cubre la zona sur de Nuevo México. Es mucho territorio, las comunidades muy lejanas una de otra, y algunas personas, muchas personas de nuestras comunidades, por cuestión de su estatus migratorio, no pueden viajar por cuestión de que tenemos chequeos en cada parte de la diócesis. Entonces procuramos nosotros, cuando hacemos reuniones, tener video en varias partes de la diócesis donde nos podamos ver y nos podamos comunicar. Es parte de la realidad, es parte de lo que hacemos para responder a la situación actual. Seguimos pidiendo la iglesia, los obispos en Estados Unidos, por una reforma integral migratoria. Seguimos pidiendo por eso, por el bien de la sociedad, por el bien de nuestras familias, por el bien humano. Mil gracias y les deseo todo lo mejor.